Hello? Yep.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to the adventures of Danny Rogers and Jerome Borazio from the Laneway Festival. Woo! Basically, what started as Jerome taking over a small Swedish meatball shop in Melbourne has blossomed into one of the kind of most renowned internationally recognized festival names in Australia. It's the Laneway Festival. We're here today to talk about kind of how they did it, why they did it. Are they still friends? Do they still talk to each other? And we'll go from there.
Carried me home last night.
Carried you home last night. Backstage, Jerome did ask if Danny had helped him. Was it take his pants off or put his pants on? I'm not sure.
Oh, no, I wasn't sure whether it was. I was taking my pants off and my shirt off at the venue last night.
That's right. Okay. So on that note, St. Jerome's Bar in Melbourne opened in 2004, but you guys met each other before then?
Yeah, we've been friends. I think we've been friends near on 12, 13 years.
Maybe just turn that mic around a little bit.
Near on 12 to 13 years before that, we met in a bar, funnily enough. And from then on, the friendship blossomed. While I was fortunate enough to stay in touch with Danny while he went overseas and worked really hard in the music industry over in America. And then from that, when he came back to Melbourne, I said, "Well, hey, I've got this little bar. We should just hang out and have a good time." And yeah, we were just working together in a bar, and I guess from that, it all unfolded.
You used to let me manage the bar on a Monday night so you could go 10-pin bowling.
Yeah.
So I used to get to run the bar on Mondays. That was fun.
I became a very good bowler, thanks.
And you said you can't let... We had two drinks when we first opened that bar. There was two drinks. There was Melbourne cans and water.
Oh, no, there was...
And people asked for too many waters. You said you have to kick them out.
Yeah.
And so then, Danny, you were starting to manage bands and book bands around that stage, and you'd done a stint in New York doing that as well.
Yeah, I was just like anyone else, just trying to, I just like music, and I love being involved in music, and I didn't know how to get involved, really, but I did. And, so I'd done a bit of that, and then when I came back to Australia, I think probably the first person I rang was Jerome after my mum just said, "Hey, I'm back." And he said, come down here immediately. So,
Let's not forget his mum and my mum wanted to keep it apart as well.
Yeah, they said, when I was 18, I went and had Jerome sort of introduced me to the nightlife. And he said, "Oh, look, we're going to have a little party at my house if you want to come." And I was playing footy at the time for a local team and where we grew up and stuff. And I was meant to play footy the next day, but Jerome had given me my first acid tab. And I played that. I got there in the second half. I played on acid. I got two kicks, one in the opposite direction. They said, "Get this guy off immediately." And Mum sort of said, "Look, I think this Jerome kid's a lovely guy. On a personal note, I think he's just a beautiful guy. He's like a son to me in some crazy way, but I just... We've spoken to his parents and we just think it'd be really, really good for you both to just keep apart from one another for as long as possible."
It's actually a true story.
And so the bar became, for anyone especially who has never went to St. Jerome's when it was open in Melbourne, it sort of became this hub for not only kind of just... I guess students and people kind of looking for something a little bit different in the city, but a lot of creative types and musos and artists and that sort of thing. And it seemed like that sort of kicked in. Danny, you were saying to me about 6 months in, you started putting on bands. It was called the Summer Series. Ended up having bands like The Presets, Architecture in Helsinki, Claire Bowditch pretty early on, just playing on a small deck out the back. And you started thinking about having a first birthday party, and the avalanche has dared you to do something.
I submitted the first application for Laneway under the premise that it was the bar's first birthday. So the council thought that was a really good idea. There was a combination of ideas. The Avalanches, obviously, were doing their secret shows, and that was gaining momentum.
Brains are playing.
Yeah, Brains. Then, obviously, Danny was booking some incredible acts, and it just, I guess, organically grew, and we felt that there was some real integrity with the music that we were putting on, and we felt that there was a really good subculture. I mean, in all honesty, what transpired was, I'd been a resident of the Melbourne CBD for now 20 years, and I couldn't get into any bars. They would never let me in bars. You're wearing thongs, or you wear, and I couldn't cope with that. So I thought, I'll build a clubhouse, and from that, I guess that sort of was the ethos was you didn't need special clothes or shoes to be included, and I think that's where it sort of gained some cultural momentum.
I think you're still wearing the same thongs that you wore.
Oh no, these are upgraded. These ones.
Upgrades. Yeah. Fantastic.
And so when the festival started, you didn't actually really know it was a festival, did you? It seemed like it kind of came out of something pretty organic.
Yeah, look, we involved all the bars around us and the food shops, and we were pretty lucky. And I think had we gone to council and said, hey, look, we want to put on a festival, I don't think it would have been as received the way it was through that. But, you know, it was basically, we just wanted to have a good time. That was the truth. We just wanted to have a good time, and we put on the bands that we loved, and that's where it escalated, I guess.
And at the time, the lane was terrible. It stank.
It was awesome.
It was really small. And so a lot of festivals at that stage were kind of drawing people to kind of specific spots, and you were making use with what you had.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of different ideas and people's inspirations. For me personally, before I'd come back to Australia, I'd been living in a place called Bedford-Stuyvesant, which is in Brooklyn in New York, and I went to a whole bunch of Brooklyn, or Bedford-Stuyvesant block parties, and I just loved how... just loved the spirit of what they were trying to do, and it was really just really sort of family orientated and community orientated, and just I don't know. So I remember saying to Jerome, like, there's all these events in Australia, they're all pretty cool or whatever. Like, some of them are good, some of them are shit. And why don't we just do something that's just really like a street party thing? Like, it wasn't really, I didn't know what that meant really, but I didn't know how to organize it. We certainly didn't organize the first one all that well.
We just made it up as we went along.
Forgot to put the roof on the stage.
Well, we didn't have a roof.
we had three guys that helped. We didn't have, and this, I was saying to Marcus the other day, because he was asking me a few questions about, and I sort of went, fuck, actually, we've really evolved from that first year in a big way in terms of, because, you know, now we've got site managers and production managers and all these different specialised people, which are all unreal people. But that first one was me and Jerome and I, a mate of ours called Monkey, who did all the artwork, and I'm sorry if I forget anyone here, Alfredo, who owned the Bull Ring, who basically pulled the stage out of the Bull Ring and put it onto the fucking, into the lane, and cleaned up, and I don't know, he had all sorts of things going on. He was a freedom fighter from Chile. We had Johnny Sparkplugs, Mr. Fix-It. He was an electrician by trade, so anything, so therefore in our mind, anything that went wrong, we just went, pressure man, fix it. And he'd just run off, and he had this big bag of tools that he carried around, and he'd just like fix things, and it was unbelievable. And just other people that were just really just, and the thing about it was everyone was just included, and like, I think the first year, I don't think there's like, it was just cash, like as in not cash, yay, more like just everything was just, there's no receipts or invoice. Like, it was very, very starting out. And I think even Avalanche said they wanted their money in a brown paper bag.
Yeah, they did.
That's what their request was.
Yeah. And you had an issue with posters as well.
Oh, I actually didn't even use email back then, by the way, in that first one. So everything was done by the phone.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, I thought... I definitely fucked up. I thought for some reason that Cut Copy were definitely going to be playing, but I hadn't asked them yet. And... And Monkey, I said, Monkey, just put it on the poster. And he screen printed 2,500 screen printed posters at his studio in Collingwood all night on his own, just like listening to music and just like screen printing these things. And then he just got out, and the whole city was just smothered in these these posters, and I got a phone call from the band's agent saying, hey, you know, are you Danny Rogers or something? I'm like, yeah, it's like, I'm Cut Copy's agent. And I was like, oh yeah, okay, let's take out, man, we need to talk actually. He's like, we really need to talk. He's like, we really fucking need to talk, buddy. My band is sitting in a cafe watching some guy put up a poster at the fucking festival they're playing. And I was like, I'm really, oh yeah, sorry, fuck, shit, sorry. Monkey.
But
just take them all down. He's like, he rang me, I'll never forget the timing. It was like, he's like, literally I got off that call and went, fuck, this is not good. And then phone call comes in, it's Monkey. I'm like, hey man, how you doing? He's like, dude, I've got every single poster up. I've been up since 7, done, man. I'm so fucking, you name a suburb, it's they're there. I'm like, oh, Monk, I gotta tell you something. It's like, ah. Oh. And that's what happened. That was our marketing budget's fucking destroyed.
But there's, despite all that, or maybe because of it, like, I think it was 1,400 people showed up and ran the laneway full.
1,365,
the numbers, man. And then not long after, Jerome, you had a chance meeting with Michael Chugg in Sydney.
Oh, no, I was actually at the Golden Door Health Retreat. as you can see, picture of health. anyway, I went up to... It was the last day of this health retreat, and there was one spare seat, and Chuggy was there, and I walked over, and I said, hey, buddy, how are you? And he said, yeah, not bad. And I said, geez, you look like you own a bed and breakfast. and his first words to me were, fuck off, son. And anyway, I said, look, hey, we just put on this little show last week, and I think you'd be interested in it. Anyway, credit to him. He was on the phone the next day. He said, boys, come up to Sydney. So Danny and I flew up, and he made us wait. We were in his office. He made us wait about an hour. So I just stormed in the office. He said, mate, who are you? Like, seriously, we've come all the way from Melbourne.
He's wearing a tracksuit. Yeah. Smoking. Wearing a tracksuit, smoking cigarettes. I thought, this is fucking Brian Brown. It's like the Brian Brown of music. I was so, like, this is incredible. It's like, I felt like I was in Cocktail. Like, Tom Cruise on my left and fucking Brian Brown on my right. I was like, this is fucking ridiculous.
So we said, you know what, this is not for us, man, we're out of here. Anyway, a week later we flew back up to Sydney, and we got on the table pretty quickly. Incredible guy to work with and his team around him. And Sydney sort of happened straight after that.
Yeah.
He had a site. He said, yeah, circular key, there's this spot, this will work, I'll fucking ring them now. And we just basically just got into a car and drove down. Walks into some of the basement where Basement Jack was sitting.
Basement
down,
Jack's,
and
this
guy was sitting down in a like overcoat.
It was 40 degrees that day.
And he was wearing an overcoat, drinking like brown spirits. Scotch. Yeah, and it was unbelievable. And he's like, right, mate, fuckhead, come here. We're fucking putting this on in this place. All right, these guys are going to run it. I'll see you guys.
Pretty much it.
Yeah, and so that was the first laneway happened in 2006 there, the Macquarie Square place. And then the following year, you got wind that maybe some people thought your idea was kind of, you're onto something, and realised that maybe you should come up to Brisbane.
Yeah, funny. I got an email from someone, a friend of mine up here, and said, hey, look, there's someone up here who is going to do your event up here. I'm just giving you a heads up because, you know, that'd be a shame if they did it because they're A, not that good at what they do, and B, they're just going to try and rip the idea off or something. I was like, oh, it's fucking boring, but all right. And he said, ring Jock from the zoo. And I'd known Jock, like, not super well, but I knew her, and I knew she was a lovely person, and I rang her up and said, what about that back street behind the zoo? And she was like, oh, that's awesome, let's do that. And so suddenly we're in Brisbane, we're just going shit.
And at that stage, were you developing sort of like a philosophy or a feeling of what the festival was and was maybe hoping to be?
I think that we just... More than anything, I think we just enjoyed putting it on. We, you know, found it to be an incredible privilege to have the opportunity to work with bands. We got to surround ourselves with some really inspiring, creative people. And I think we just enjoyed hanging out because we just always just had a really fun time and would get up to all sorts of, you know, stupid things. And that was really it. So it was a great time for all that. And I think we started to realise, shit, people really like this, you know, like this is bloody...
Well, I mean, we were having a good time doing
it. Yeah, but people really like it. They think this is really good. And, you know, we had really good support from the industry, all the local promoters. I don't think there's a local promoter in Australia that hasn't booked at least one band on the bill. And we wanted to do something that wasn't all, like, even though it was our event, we were really wanting to have lots of people involved and encouraging people and, yeah, sort of made it up as we went along and...
Still are.
And, yeah, just didn't... I'm not trying to sound too casual about it because we were ambitious to do a great show now and it's obviously evolved a lot. But back then, I think it was just, let's just have a great time and see what we can pull off, you know?
Yeah. And the festival expanded really quickly. You know, in 2008, you moved to Adelaide. You expanded in Melbourne to start taking over Lonsdale Street, which is a pretty main thoroughfare in the Melbourne CBD. The city and the cities that it was happening in started to sort of take a sense of ownership, and you were working pretty closely with people to try and make that happen. But then in 2009, it maybe was the victim of its own success all of a sudden, particularly in Melbourne and a little bit in Sydney.
That was an interesting time for the festival. We went out there just obviously trying to provide the greatest environment to see live music that we could and showcase Melbourne. There's a few legal issues that transpired, you know, the night before the festival, which changed the footprint.
Legal licensing.
Yeah.
For anyone who's not aware, in 2009 in Melbourne, there were some problems with queues, some people being locked out of, like ticket holders being locked out of various areas, not being able to get into some parts of the venue. So some police got involved at some point.
It was a total fuck up, let's just be honest. But, you know, and at the end of the day, as the promoters, you have to go, yeah, we fucking totally stuffed up. But we had some real legitimate sort of hurdles. It was like going into a grand final with a broken arm and a hamstring. Like, the council all year, it said, go and do all this. And look, and we were like, well, then if you're really that supportive, what about the Melbourne, like, we did a state library, a free event? And the whole idea had been, there'd be a stage where Girl Talk played, which is where we had major issues. They made us push the stage about halfway up the street when we'd always planned to put it like up until the Friday. Literally the Friday said, no, you've got to hear your red line areas here. They just put all these things and they made us do this walkway between friggin' Meyer and this. Oh, it's just like, this is a disaster. Yeah. Like, this is a disaster. But we just went, all right, let's just roll the dice. We can't cancel the show. We've just got to do what we're going to do. And, by about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, I'm like, this is a disaster. Jerome's up in some pub somewhere about three blocks away drinking beers or something. I'm like, mate, you might want to come back down here and have a quick look at what's going on.
Too busy.
And yeah, it was really unfortunate. And lots of people, most importantly, the people there were just really upset. And it made us realise that they are upset because they really gave a fuck about the show. Like, we got so many emails from people going, you know, I told five of my friends, like, this is the one we should go to. We're going to go to a festival. This is, like, people really... And so we sat for a second and we thought about how we would handle it. And then I said to Jerome, we've just got to ring every single person up that's, like, complained. Let's just ring every... It might take fucking months, but let's just do it. Which is much harder thing to do than I realised, but... So we sent a note out saying, look, if people want to talk, the promoters are willing to talk to you one-on-one. And we rang myself, predominantly Bonnie Dalton, someone who's worked with us for a long time, really good friend. She and I probably rang about 250 people. She rang about 70, and Jerome rang about 3 or 4.
Yeah.
Mainly his mates.
Getting a real sense.
Hey, Bluey, were you at the festival?
Getting a real sense of the work-life balance between you guys on the festival.
So
getting a really good sense of the work-life balance between you two. But you learn a lot of lessons from that year. It was starting to get a bit squeezy in Sydney as well. I remember that year.
We go out every year just trying to improve the show. You know, what can we do better? We're very focused on I guess, the one percenters and delivering a better show every year. And that was a real good kick in the ass for us, basically.
I think we just went, all right, this is a moment. We're either going to not do this anymore or we're going to step up and really try and make this the show that we maybe, that everyone expects us to do, really. Yeah. And it was funny because I was in Footscray. I went to see a hip-hop group playing at the Community Arts Centre in the little, there's a little amphitheatre, and I went there with my wife, and I'm like, oh, this is cool down here. This is brilliant. Like, and I was looking over at the city backdrop, and I was like, this is, wow, this is awesome. Like, just give us 5 or 10 minutes. Go for a bit of a walk. And I came back. I said, we've found the Laneway site. This has definitely got, and then I rang Jerome and said, look, let's just come and meet me. And we walked it, and I said, these guys are going to love it. And we went and met the sort of the CEO at the time of the college, and of the Community Arts Centre, and she was just like, oh, this is amazing. And she sort of helped us sort of navigate into the council and the local sort of stakeholders and stuff. And comparatively to what we'd, all the sort of issues we'd had in the city with, like, fucking people that just have no idea, like, everyone in that community was just so excited and
they embraced it
and they turned it into, they owned it, you know, and we just went for it and we thought, okay, let's have a go. And that was a year when, you know, Florence and
Mumford,
and that was, I'd moved to London, and so I was just really, it was probably quite fortunate in terms of just, I was right in the perfect timing, and I met these, I actually just met all three bands in the space of about 3 months, and I booked them on, but I never was like, these bands are going to be huge. It was never like that. It was just like, oh, these bands are all pretty good. Yeah, let's do it. You know, it was really that simple. So.
And that same year, you expanded the Sydney College of the Arts in Rozelle. That, I guess, with those growing pains, and especially that time in Melbourne, was it, did those sort of things ever kind of come close to compromising your friendship?
No, not really, not at all. I mean, there was that particular year. There was a lot of pressure. There were some things that unfolded. You know, bar staff got assaulted. The venue got broken into straight after it the next day, and I was focused on dealing with those safety issues. And as Danny said, he called 200, and I probably called about 10 or 12. But you know, that was a high pressure time, and I think from that, you know, we basically eyeballed each other and said, hey, how's this going to unfold? And are you in this for the long haul or not? And we haven't looked back since.
Yeah.
So, well, I wouldn't think the friendship's been compromised at all. I think it just grows stronger every day.
And it turned out that 2010 year with the expansion to Footscray and Sydney was and also those bands that were on it was kind of an instant success. And it seemed like that your audience gave you a chance, basically, and that you'd sort of built this ecosystem that was willing to do that, and they were rewarded, for lack of a better term.
And we did want to reward them. We said, look, thanks for the opportunity, and we wanted to just smash it out of the park. So,
all the people that we rang, we and some of them ring on behalf of other people as well. So they were like, they'd be like, look, me and seven of my mates. I'm like, really, seven? Fuck. Oh, okay. And, you know, so we gave them all tickets. We gave them all free tickets to the following year. I just said, listen, like, you and how many? I said, I'm not even going to check. You just tell us how many. And they're like, well, there was six of us. I'm like, then I'll send six tickets. Send me your address. And so we sent out about, really in the end, it was about 600 tickets. So it wasn't like a lot, really, the scheme of things. And I said, look, there's one rule. You know, we want you guys to give us genuine, honest feedback about this show. If it's shit, tell us. If it's great, if you want to tell us, you know what I mean? But, and so, I reckon we got about 300 emails back from people sort of being really honest about this show, and that was really helpful, you know, because it helps you look at other ways you can make it better, and, oh, what about this idea, and can you take it down to the water, and this stage wasn't too good because of this tree, like, just stuff, like, it's just punter experience, and, I thought that was really, really great. So, and we didn't hassle them and anything. We just said, thanks very much. And
yeah,
that's it. Feel free to reach out to us again if you want.
Because I think some people have, or especially music fans, might have the idea that festival promoters are kind of, you know, off limits. kind of making decisions behind the scenes and then raking in all their cash with little thought to it. But yeah, it must have been interesting to have that direct contact.
Well, it's never really been about the money. It was about delivering the best show we possibly could.
It's about having fun. Yeah. Mm. And not losing money.
And
we're in the wrong business then.
Then you decided to try and take your chances in Singapore the next year.
Yeah, that was a chuggy vision, you know, like people go, chuggy, yeah, what the fuck would he know? Mate, guy's a fantastic person. And he's like, mate, I've got an office in Singapore, fucking we're gonna go there. Fucking let's go. If I can get this chick there, she's gonna help us. Just fucking do it. I was like, really? Singapore? That's incredible. What are you doing there, mate? Just, mate, it's fucking, it's game on in Asia, mate. And and away we went. And we went over there, and oh, it was just a trip, really. It was just an absolute trip. And, you know, he was like a celebrity in Singapore, like Sir Chug over in Singapore. And was like, what's going on here?
And especially for a festival that was so built around, you know, friendships with initially even the artists that were playing and the people that were surrounding it. Like, how did you think that could translate to another culture? And how did you
put Florence on in there and the XX in Singapore, and they both sold out really quickly. And so we knew there was people connecting to that style of music in the market. We didn't know how many or anything like this, but it's definitely a fan base. And they're kind of, people like to go there, but when it's like, so we just thought, there's nothing really there that's been done. And the first one we did, I think we had about 4,000, 5,000 people there, which was astonishingly awesome.
In torrential rain.
But it was like, I've never seen, like it was the most challenging festival we'd ever had. It was torrential rain. I mean, talking, you couldn't see me from where you guys are at all.
Rainway.
Like, and they called it Rainway.
Yeah,
the locals dubbed it Rainway. And it got really great reviews, and the bands loved it, and it was fucking nuts. But it was, and we thought, shit, this is shit.
Pretty well received.
Yeah.
It's got the potential to be the biggest show.
Right.
So that's really exciting.
Is there a tradition of those sort of shows in Singapore previously? Was that a sort of, were you introducing a brand new concept?
I don't think it had been done on the scale that we attempted to do it. There's other festivals that have toured over there, obviously, but they're very discerning in their music tastes over there, and I think we've catered to a particular market, and it's been super well received. So I feel really proud of Singapore, actually.
Mm. And that perhaps, yes and no, but that perhaps sort of led into expanding a little bit further. You'd started putting on parties at South by Southwest. You had a stage in the UK.
Yeah, we just need a legitimate reason to go to.
Yeah, so I was like, should we go there for a holiday? Why not do the festival there? That was the way of thinking. But then Detroit came in not long after. How did that come about?
I received a phone call from a chap in New York saying, this guy's called Marty Diamond. He looks like Danny DeVito or something. Really, he's hilarious. And he's like, hey, Danny, you know, it's Marty Diamond. And I was like, hey, mate, yeah, nice. Yep, what's happening? He's like, listen, man, I got want something a bit different. I'm like, okay. He's like, listen, you ever thought about bringing Laneway to America? I was like, yeah, we've been asked a few times and it hasn't really eventuated and, you know, whatever. He goes, all right. This is a bit one to be like to sit down and take this in, have a think about this. It's like Detroit. I'm like, we're in. Yeah. It was like that. Yeah. I ring Jerome, I'm like, all right, we're gonna go to Detroit for a few days. You up for it? And he's like, yeah, that sounds awesome. So we went to Detroit and hanging out with Derek Carter, and remember he rocked up and he's like that Mustang?
Yeah.
His old Mustang. And just all these local Detroit people, and we just fell in love with the people. The people were so
partners are incredible.
They were just really great, beautiful, really humble, very working class town, and just really, really amazing music history, and a really, really fucked up situation. And we were just like, we don't have a choice. Like, we've got to. This is.
We felt like we could make a difference there.
So we got a little team, and we just said to them, look, all right, we're in, but it's up to you guys to really, if you think the same way, then we're in, simple as that. And so, yeah, then we just programmed the festival. One of Marty's partners, Kevin French, and I programmed it together, and we got Sigur Rós and The National and Deer Hunter, and Churches played, Solange, Flume, Chet Faker. It was fucking insane. The lineup was just unbelievable. Killer Mike with them. We booked Killer Mike at the festival because he comes up to Jerome and I. He's like, hey guys, all I've ever wanted to do is meet a koala in Australia. We're like, all right, you're on. You're coming. He's like, really? So him and Killer and LP came back. But yeah, they played. It was the most
surreal experience of the whole Laneway journey. I just remember standing on a hill looking out. Just going, wow, we're actually in America doing this.
The Detroit Marching Band, which was this bunch of sort of vagabonding kind of lunatics just cruising around with instruments around the site randomly, just playing, and it was just unbelievable. We did some collaborations with Movement, which is the Detroit Electronic Music Festival, with Ghostly International, which is an amazing Michigan-based label. It was just really collaborative, and lots of artists. We had live artists, well, they organized this, live artists doing paintings, like while they're watching shows. Like, it was just, we bought about 10 paintings between, and we couldn't figure out how to get them back.
I only got one of them back to Australia, unfortunately.
Was it difficult to stand there, in another country and see your creation kind of being, I guess, used by, a completely different kind of crowd or an idea that is very different from how it started? And do you see similarities or differences when you're doing that in Singapore?
Well, there was a huge music appreciation over there, and they respected what we did, and that was the encouraging thing for us. It wasn't just about buying a ticket to some summer party. It was people who really wanted to be there, and I guess that's been the ethos or the what's gone through the festival the whole time that we've built it. And we felt very comfortable there, and we just, it was a very, very proud moment. Sure.
And we didn't sell enough tickets. They lost about, I hope I'm not wrong, they lost a lot of money putting the show on, and we felt really bad about that, but it was what it was. And I really expected a phone call, like, you're going to have to take off that fourth stage, or you're going to have to cut the production, or we can't be doing this artwork stuff. They just wanted to do an amazing job, and they just got behind and said, look, it is what it is. All we care about is putting on a phenomenal show. And so they really had the same motivations as we did, and that was evident in that week before the festival. And when we arrived into Detroit, there was about 25 people or something came out from Australia, like friends and family and people that work with us. And they had this, remember the Detroit, they'd organized a big bike ride. The Laneway welcome party, and there's all these people, like 500 people rode bikes around Detroit to welcome us.
Slow ride or something.
The slow ride, just drinking and just smoking joints and having conversations. And
sounds terrible.
We didn't make it. No.
And so I suppose if there's a common thread between those things working in far-flung places, it's what? The approach to music, the approach to booking, the ethos behind the care that you take as music curators, or the experience that you're trying to put on?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think either of us or anyone that works with us would profess that we're just regular people, like we're not expert programmers or whatever that is. Like, we just book what we like, and just try and, obviously the events grow in popularity or whatever, you sort of have to sort of understand your audience a little more and all that jazz, but we just love doing it, and we don't always get it right. We've only got 30 or 32 slots, and we miss stuff, or we make, sometimes we'll go, look, it's probably, like last year, the band I should have booked, felt really, not that they necessarily would have played, but Big Scary, I was like, how did I miss that one? That's fantastic. So just stuff like that, you're always just pushing yourself, but also really aware that you're only human, you're going to make mistakes, you're going to get some things right. As long as there's a consistency, and long as it's, you know, and it's done from the heart, then you can't ask for much more. So,
as a music journalist who reads a lot of interviews with other artists and articles and whatnot, it's almost surprising how often it seems that Laneway artists talk about the festival in print, or it seems like to you know, you'll see an artist talking about how they were recommended the Laneway Festival from someone else that had played there. And it seems like bands always want to come back if they can.
We spend a lot of time with the artists, and we invest our own personal time. I guess, they've made the effort to come out. The least we can do is look after them. And, we're with them for 3 weeks, or 3.5 weeks, pretty much 7 days a week. So, and we're pretty proud of what we do, and we want them to have the best experience they possibly can. So it's a very personal relationship with a lot of artists.
Danny Brown last year was anyone at the Melbourne Laneway Festival by any chance?
One pretty person. Popular festival.
Fucking awesome. Thanks so much. Anyway, he had some technical problems before his show, and how he sort of warms up before a show, he sort of gets into the zone, and he's just on his own, and he just gets himself really, really sort of into the moment. And so that moment got broken because of his technical problems, and he just lost it, and he just went off the stage.
Wild.
Fucking fuck this shit. Fuck. And I was with Wally DeBacker driving a golf buggy past the stage. Just unbelievable coincidence of just saying, "Hey mate, how you been?" Chatting, and we're driving down to see Lord. I sort of needed to get to see Lord at the start of the show because, obviously her mum was, it was just a big thing to make sure we were around. And so, so he comes running off the stage, and I'm like, "Fuck, what's going on here?" So I stop the golf cart, get out, and I'm like, "Yeah, he's like," and he just runs off, like, just not, no one knows. I'm like, "Fuck, where is he?" And the crowd's like, "Danny Brown, Danny." I'm like, "Oh, fuck."
He was pretty
so bad. I just go on a mission to try and find him. I'm asking anyone, "Have you seen Danny Brown?" It's like, "I haven't seen." And then someone goes, "Yeah, I think I'm like, finally I find a pattern." And he's ended up going back into the band room. So I go into the dressing rooms. I'm looking at Danny. I can't find him anywhere. Go down, and I didn't even know it existed, but there was like this underground fucking bunker thing inside. And I'm like, it's pitch black. I've never met Danny because we've only just started the tour. Walk down, I'm like, "Danny," and he's just down there. He's got he's really upset. And I'm like, "Oh, fuck." And he's sitting down on the step. I'm like, "Danny, how you going?" I'm Danny as well. I'm the promoter. all I can hear in the back is, "Danny Brown." And I'm like, "Oh, fuck, this is crazy." He stands up, and he's fucking pretty tall. And I'm not. And he's just like, "Man." And I'm like, "Oh, fuck." And no one knows I'm down there. No one knows me. I'm just like, and I'm like, "Man, listen, man, we fucked up. It happens, shit happens, life happens. This is real time. Like, this is what's going on right now in our lives right now. Like, it just is what it is." It was like, "Man, if I was an NBA player, it's like, you give me a fucking flat ball." I'm like, fucking genius. I'm like, "That is exactly what I gave you. I gave you a flat ball, but I've pumped it back up, and we've got to get back out onto the fucking spot." It's like, "Where's the fucking?" I'm like, he goes, "The DJ. Where's my hype man?" I'm like, "Your hype man's up on the stage." We go, "Are they really?" I'm like, "I don't know where the fuck these guys are either." I'm like, "They're up on the stage. They're up on the stage." It's like, "Oh, okay, man. This is fucking not good, man. I'll fucking talk to you after the show, man." I'm like, "Yes, just get up there." So as we're walking towards the stage, the hype man and his DJ, I'm like, "Oh, fuck!" And Robbie and
LP.
Mr. fucking Pizza Man from the Avalanches. "What's going on, man?" I'm like, "Dude, just come with us. We'll just walk with Danny." And so we walked in, and then Jerome comes out. He goes, "What's going on, man?" I'm like, "All right, once this guy gets on stage, I've got to go down to Lord, and you're fucking minding this. And if anything goes wrong, it's your problem. I don't give a fuck anymore. I'm done." He's like, "What's going on?" I'm like, "Just fucking stay on the stage. Just don't leave."
It was pretty intense.
And he got up on stage and smashed it. And then, we got on with the show and everything happened. And the next day we're in Sydney, and he came into the green room, and he sort of walked over, and he's walking in with his gang. And he just came straight over and just gave me a massive hug and just said, "Man, I'm so sorry about yesterday. I was so..." And I said, "Dude, fucking,
who gives a shit? Like, it's like, it was like, it's, I'm sorry what happened. Like, it shit happens, right? And he's like, but we just, it was a really amazing bond, you know, and he just really felt so looked after. And then for the whole time, I said, look, we're going to have someone there the whole time who's just your guy. You can just talk to him and your guy. And he's like, oh, that's amazing. Like, can we just...
The experience was incredible.
You know, Jerome was driving from Adelaide Airport to the hotel, and he went, what the fuck? Archie's just walking. Archie from King Cruel was just, like, walking, thinking he was going to the beach or something.
Yeah.
Didn't you pick him up and take him? He was, like, dehydrated.
He ended up... Fair skin, red hair, in 40 degree heat.
And he wearing a tracksuit. Him and Chuggy have a lot in common.
So we picked him up after a 4.5 hour walk because his mates decided to leave him at the beach. he had no phone, no wallet. but like, you know, as Danny's saying, it's a very personal, very hands-on from both of us. And I think that's what the artists really enjoy.
And our team, it's not just us.
Well, like, yeah, of course.
We're not, like, there's all, when I say team, it's a bit fucking yay, but definitely a lot of people involved that we work with who contribute so much to the event, and they're really the unsung heroes in a lot of ways. Like, there's a lot of really, really talented, mega music passionate people that work in this. It's a real egoless place in a lot of ways. Like, you know, there's no, like, hierarchies, and it's the same with the lineups. I mean, you get bands that are, you know, maybe blowing up or whatever, but as a rule, we try and make it so from start to finish, everyone's treated equally. Yeah, sure, you might get an extra bottle of whiskey or something, you know, but it's not like people feel like they're, you know, looked after. And even this year, when I'm looking at the playing times, I'm like, fuck, you know, it's a few bands that are playing pretty early, and so we're going to rotate those slots in every city. So, you know, the bands play at different times, and like, just wherever you end up, but you might play early one day, but you'll play later the next time, and just try and give people like the right feeling, and that's really important to all of us, you know.
Laneway's sort of built this knack for basically kind of showcasing bands that are just on the verge of breaking or becoming popular, or you know, worth, you know, just getting in before other people, I suppose. Was that ever an intention behind the festival, or was that just something that occurred naturally?
Yeah, it wasn't ever an intention. Like, it was definitely, and it still sort of isn't in a way. Like, I mean, we obviously, there's a sense that we've done that a few times, and that's fantastic. Anyone that books a festival will tell you that sometimes, you know, you luck out. You know, sometimes you miss out. Like, there's acts that, you know, I would have loved to have had the War on Drugs on Laneway, the playing on Meredith, you know, like, it's like, there's lots of that sort of stuff. But yeah, no, I think we just, yeah, I don't know, we listened to a lot of, like, it's not just, like, I booked the acts with Trav and Katie, essentially, but there's lots of, we just have conversations with people, and, you know, there's lots of people that have got great music taste and ideas, and they just, and we just sort of listen to what they say and think about it, and then like make a decision based on a whole bunch of different people's sort of collective ideas. So yeah, and I mean, of course, it's great when you've got an act that's, you know last year was Lord, and I mean, the Lord thing was another one where, like, she came to Laneway in Auckland. We got a phone call from her manager the year before. We didn't know her or him, and said, oh, look, there's this girl and she's 16, and I know you're an over 18s, and we went, yeah, didn't really know anything more than, oh, she's 16, she's awesome, she's a music fan, it's great. So just don't drink and go berserk if you can. No, she's just here to see music. She's really just here. I said, well, fucking awesome, come in. And so about 2 or 3 weeks later or something, we got an email just saying, look, this artist that played the other, so thank you so much, and she just wants to play Laneway. That's all she wants to do. Like, she just wants to play Laneway. I was like, sure. I listened to Royals, and I thought it was obviously a great song, but I wasn't like, this is a massive hit. I never thought that. I just thought that was a really, really great song, and I thought the video was incredible, and I was like, fuck, yeah, for sure, let's do it. So I guess the point there is that those things happen for different, like, things happen for different, and there's no one particular way in which an act's been booked on the bill. Like, in this year, it's like, we came out of last year's lineup, and that was a really great lineup.
but let's not try and emulate it. Let's try and just continue to create something that's like fresh and exciting for us, and stick with the philosophy of just, if there's a philosophy, it's that there's no headliners. It's just a really solid lineup, and you know, there's more no's than yeses, and that's actually really shit. It's not nice to a lot of people that we really like and respect, both managers and artists, of course, that you have to say no to, and that's actually one of the shit things about the festival, to be honest.
Yeah, with the last year's lineup especially, I mean, you had Lord, Haim, and Vance Joy, who sort of all broke through to kind of, I guess, arguably a more commercial space than you guys would have been used to previously. Is there almost a danger in that happening, in terms of the kind of philosophy that you've had so far with Laneway?
Yeah, look, I mean, I guess so, but we just sort of, I sort of think, all right, if we don't sell out this year, that's fine, that's cool. The lineup's awesome. We'll get to 70 or 80%. It'll still be a great festival. We're not sort of, of course we want to sell all the tickets and all that stuff, but we're not going to obsess over that and try and become something that we're not to do that, you know, and that's, that, I don't think that's going to change, because I think if it did, we'd just get really bored.
The focus is on delivering the best show that we can. So if it sells out, that's just a bonus.
Yeah. I mean, you've been doing it for just over 10 years now. Is there a point when you feel like perhaps you're going to have to hand over the reins? Or what's your vision for the next little window?
I've been handing over the reins for a while. It's too much fun. I guess, like I said earlier, it's about those 1%ers. We just want to keep improving the show every single way we can. We're very hands-on across pretty much every single detail that, you know, in all the states, and when opportunities like Detroit present themselves, you know, we just analyse it properly, and if we're into the idea, then, you know, we'll still have a crack at it.
So yeah. I think the programming sometimes, I'm like, shit, I'm turning 40 this year, do I fucking really know what kids want? Because I, you know, I'd probably listen to Double J, you know what I mean? Like, guilty. I guess that, yeah, so we have put a couple of people in as like young. We've got three people actually. We've got a fantastic young kid called Dom. My son's called Dom as well, that's why he probably got the gig. He's been at FBI for about 4 years, and he's a young kid there, he's just turned 18, so he's like a bit of a scouty dude. And there's another guy called David Goldsmith who's come in, and I'm sort of trying to, I don't know if the right word is train, but just show them a little bit about how it's done and to understand the process, and with the view that, you know, at some point in the next, you know, 5 years or something, I might just go, hey, look, I need to just not do this for a year, and I've got the right people, hopefully, who've learnt. I've also got Trav in there as well, who's overseeing those guys. So we're looking at ways to kind of, but the thing about it is I still love the programming, so it's like, it's not really a job, it's actually, you know, it's just amazing thing to do.
Especially in the last, I guess, kind of decade, but more acutely in the last 5 or so years, is the Australian kind of festival landscape has been pretty in a state of upheaval, especially with your Big Day Out kind of being pretty uncertain, perhaps finished, Harvest, you know, you could name a bunch of them. Do you guys see yourself as even part of that kind of thing, or
no?
What?
not in a mean way. Like, just we don't have an opinion really, because I don't really. You know, if you ask me about festivals that I think are phenomenal in this country, I think Meredith and Golden Plains are two of the best festivals this country has. And I think there's other good things out there, but I think that's got a story. It's about friendship. It's about music, and it's about bringing people together. And when you do those things and you do it with integrity, I think people understand that and they see it. And, you know, in the case of Meredith, it's bigger than anyone. Like, it's its own thing. Like, it's just, and that's always something that I think that's what we want to be. We're a totally different event, totally different event. But as a model of cultivating
an integrity and a sensibility, then I feel like that's a great example. People are not stupid, and that's the thing. When if you treat them like idiots, they'll treat you like idiots. You know what I mean? And so if you just go in there, it's really obvious that you're just trying to make a ton of cash and, you know, all that stuff. People see through it, and you know, and after a while they get tired of it. So,
Kind of starting to get towards the end. I get the feeling that some people probably want to hear a little bit of juicy gossip. Maybe. Can you recount some sort of high highs or low lows that you've had across the years?
There's been a lot of both.
That are legal?
every year presents different challenges for us, and touch wood, everything's been pretty positive. So in regards to anything super juicy, there's a lot of people in this room that sort of know us pretty well. And,
has there been a moment that you've kind of that you've stopped to take in perhaps everything that's happened? I mean, you know, what was once a little bar is, well, careers for one thing, but also something that a lot of people feel ownership over as fans.
It's just been a very natural progression. So for us, on a day-to-day basis, there's a conversation about Laneway every day, and it's just become part of our lives. It's a very positive environment to be in, so you know, I can't be thankful enough to be involved in this project. So
yeah, no, I feel the same way. I mean, I think I can't think of anything specific, to be honest. I think there's always going to be challenges, and we're not sort of complacent that it's just going to fall into place, or you know, we don't know. We could have a resident get all excited, or we could get like there's just all sorts of things, but. Sort of what makes it exciting as well. Like you sort of never know really exactly what's going to happen. On any show day, you've got four stages on. You've got, you know, say in Melbourne, there's 15,000 people in streets, closed down streets with residents at the back and factories and a river down the side. You're just going, this is fucking pretty full on here right now, you know. And your mum walks into the crowd, you go, oh shit, what have I done? You know. In fact, one time that was a fucking ugly moment. Caledonian Lane, when some guy, we were serving cans of Melbourne, of course, and some guy's thrown a can, a full can, right into the crowd. I've seen him. I was like, literally, just didn't know who I was. He's just pissed, and it's gone like that, and he's thrown the can, and it's gone past my, missed my mum's head, like, but honestly, like that much. She was sitting there talking to Joe Watson, thinking the world had changed, you know. But,
We've got about 5 minutes left. Would anyone like to ask a question / try and get their band on the Laneway lineup in the next few minutes? Okay. See any, there's one over there in the corner.
Hi, my name's Kim. We run a small boutique festival. It's our second year this year at the New Globe Theatre in March called Mojo Burning. And this year we're taking it to Sydney, only in its second year as a sideshow. What advice would you give to those smaller bills and the lineups? I mean, we've got some great bands playing, but what advice would you give to help promote those smaller initial set-up festivals?
I'd sort of ask you the question: What was the motivation for you and your friends to start the festival?
It's based around blues rock. We are a blues rock agency.
You guys are really passionate about it?
Yeah, we just love the music. And last year was fantastic. Like, the bands that we had were amazing. And this year we've got Gay Paris and Red Coats on the lineup. And again, two fantastic blues rock acts. But just that sort of being able to get people aware of what's going on. And how do you, as an initial small festival, take it to that?
Just tell the story of the artists and just be passionate. It's not rocket science, so just, you know what I mean? Like, so just be who you are, and if you're passionate about the music, then that'll shine through. Be patient.
People will find the quality music. Yeah, definitely, they'll look out for it. And if you just keep producing a lineup with integrity, they'll search it out.
Okay, cool, thanks.
Are there any other questions? Anyone else have something? Everyone's feeling pretty sated. I believe that we might have an exclusive for the 2015. And it's that we're about to sing Iggy Azalea's Fancy.
A cappella.
No. I believe there's something that you can share about next year's lineup.
Yeah, we have actually. I'm really fucking excited about it. This is possibly the most exciting act that we've ever booked on the festival. We booked her yesterday. And I'm going to read you out the message that she sent us Australians. She hails from, I believe, Alberta, Edmonton. And she is the mother of Mac DeMarco. And her name is Agnes. So yesterday I was talking to Agnes's new agent, Mac DeMarco's agent, Michelle, and said, he's so excited about coming down for Laneway. I said, you guys have emailed me so many times about the lineup. I've never had anyone email me about who's on the lineup. But she's like, oh, he just wants to know who's on the bill. I'm like, mate, I've got lots of bands on the bill. He's like, oh, look, he's so excited. I said, that's awesome. We're excited. There's one revelation there. And he said, oh, the only thing he's a bit bummed out about is that his mum, he really would want to get his mum down. Just never, I was like, oh, why does he just bring it down? She's like, oh, I can't afford it. And she wasn't angling or anything, and I just said, you know what? Like, let's bring her down. Let's fly her down. She's like, you serious? I'm like, yeah, let's fly down. Let's fly. What's her name? She's like, Agnes. I'm like, oh, I had an auntie, Agnes. Beautiful name. Look, do you reckon she could MC the festival? And she went, are you fucking serious? I'm like, I'm serious. If she wants to, she wants me to fly her down, she has to MC the festival. So she's on text messaging Mac, and Mac's like, I'll ask her now, and then he comes back within about 5 minutes and says, yeah, she's in, right? And then we FaceTime Mac, who's taking a shit on a toilet. With his big gap-toothed smile, and he's like that. And then we got this beautiful email from Agnes this morning. She said, everybody, I did talk to Mac, and I'm over the moon. I'd be a great MC. I'm happy to do it. I'm one of those people you stick a mic in front of my face and I'm good to go. God help me. I think it's a great idea for fan club and a wonderful opportunity for me, and I'm so grateful. I'll get confirmation from work that I can take time off. Even if I can't, I'm coming. I've never been off the continent. This is a wonderful, wonderful thing. My life is just opening up. I'm so happy. God bless you all. Agnes. Kiss, kiss, kiss. Hug, hug, hug. Agnes!
So there we have it. So Mac DeMarco's mother is playing.
Yep, she's going to MC. We're going to give her a special pass that she can, like, basically do anything she wants. Like, you walk on the stage, like, Mac can be playing, she can just go, all right, move over, Mac. I'm just going to have a quick chat. Hi, everyone. Nice day, isn't it?
So if Danny Brown flips out, you can send her down into the hole.
I said to Jerome last night, the only person going to be really upset when they hear it, everyone will be like, oh, I want to get my mum on the festival. And that's, Nick Albrook said to me earlier, he's like, my mum should, one day. Killer Mike, man. We've got to, like, Killer Mike will want to get his mum down here. Like, that, because he always wanted to come to Australia with his mum. So maybe that'll be our next mum.
Year after.
So, yeah, it's crazy. It's kind of, it's amazing. So, yeah, all right. It's really exciting.
That's all we have time for. Please thank Jerome Borazio and Danny Rogers.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks, everyone. Have a great day. Enjoy this fantastic event.